want to sit with George or sit with
George? Do you
George.
Want to sit with me?
Yeah, okay.
I want to sit near the front.
My name, I was reliably informed, Frederick Rudolph Wills. I will be your chairman. You want to start these proceedings? When a politician realizes diminution in support, it's time to wonder. Anyway, we shall start these proceedings. Sonata in C major for unaccompanied violin, the fourth movement, allegro. And your talented musician will be Seth Taylor. Seth Taylor, please.
Thank you.
founder of the Schiller Institute, my very, very good friend indeed, Helga Zepp-LaRouche.
Ladies and gentlemen, I want to welcome you to this new Bretton Woods conference. The reference to Bretton Woods we are only making because the Bretton Woods era has come to an end. And our aim is something quite different, namely to work towards the establishment of a just new world economic order, and that the Bretton Woods system never was. Since its foundation, the Schiller Institute has worked and constituted itself in order to defend the inalienable right of all people on our planet. And these very rights, human inalienable rights right now, are threatened all over the world in the most fundamental way. As a matter of fact, one could say that maybe the world is in the most severe crisis of all of its history. We are at the beginning of a world depression. We have experienced the first crash last October. We are absolutely certain that the next phases of financial crash will come no later than the spring. And the consequences of this financial crash in terms of the real economy will be absolutely horrifying and devastating for the developing countries who are already stricken with hunger, epidemics, and horrible conditions. But also the consequences for the large majority of people in the industrialized sector is going to be very, very devastating if this process is not being reversed. And the gap between fewer and fewer very rich people and an increasing number of people who will be hit by poverty is going to grow. The reason why we thought it is necessary to conduct this conference is because the existing governments and institutions are very clearly incapable of learning from history, of learning the lessons from the last depression where fascism and world war were the outcome. And they seem to repeat the same mistakes they have been doing then. The big danger right now is that certain influential forces all over the world are trying to find solutions based on the old philosophies of Schacht and Keynes. And they say, let's take the best of each as if there was such a thing. But what it really means is what people are planning to implement right now is fascist economics all over the world. This happens to be in a situation where the consequences of the economic breakdown already is leading to severe tensions in the Western alliance, and the Soviet Union is just waiting to decouple its ally, Western Europe, from the United States. There are people who are thinking about rearranging the world according to supranational institutions, where basically national sovereign governments would disappear completely, and instead we would have kind of world government institutions, the IMF, the World Bank, GATT, but in the end, they think that in the continuous series of crashes, only 10 banks will be left over. This would then obviously eliminate any kind of national sovereignty. The Schiller Institute has been founded as a Republican Institute for Foreign Policy because we believe that only national sovereignty of governments can protect and defend the freedom of the individual. And for us, the freedom of the individual is in the center of all politics. So therefore, we are holding this conference in order to work towards a solution, even at this late hour in history, to bring together forces from all over the world and basically bring together the kind of combination which can turn history around and avoid a disaster. I want to introduce to you now the chairman of this conference, my very dear friend Fred Willis, who is not only the former Minister of Foreign Affairs and Justice of Guyana, but who is one of the outstanding fighters for a just new world economic order in this world.
But it is true that four decades ago, when I was a student in Europe, we would meet filled with the radical missionary zeal of youth, wanting to see the old world go spinning down, as the poet said, spinning down the ringing grooves of change, new economic order. We believed in those days, and we still do, that life is the fundamental essentiality of natural process. Life has to come into existence. Life has to survive. Life has to grow. Life has to develop. We were sure then, as I am sure now, that the assumptions of present existence are unacceptable. Unacceptable. One only has to regard the madness that is going on outside. Once again, I have to join with you and my very, very good friend Lyndon and Helga in refighting the battle for the interpretation of reality. Because that's what's at stake. I must pause and ask you. Bear with me while I remember those who have fallen in this fight for a just new economic order. There are many of them, but in particular, I want to remember Indira Gandhi, Abdel Nasser, Kwame Nkrumah, and Marshall Tito, whom I met, these four, as pillars of what we call the Nonaline Movement. They are dead, and as the poet said, they shall grow up old, as we who are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun, and in the morning, we shall remember. And in remembering them, I will ask you to rededicate and recommit yourselves to the purposes of this conference. Because it is clear what is happening, it is clear what the solution should be, the only problem is the will to implement it. That mankind has to intervene is all of us. Quality, nature, promptness, efficacy of that intervention is what we have met here in Andover. Consider. Let me remind those of you who are too young, Lyndon LaRouche is always accusing me of youth. I think the Prime Minister sometime or other said that it's intolerable crime of being a young man. I shan't quote that Prime Minister's name because apart from the big accusation of youth, that's all we shared in common was But there are three outstanding events I want you to recall that happened after the Second World War. Three outstanding events. Generalized technological advance took the form of the nuclear age. That was very important. Secondly, there was a proliferation of new states in the world. I'll give you one example. In Africa, there were three independent states in 1939. 1987, they are now 50. There's an immense balkanization of Africa, and by and large, they've created not nation states, but what I call state nations. They deem you to be a state, and therefore a nation. The third thing, that's why we're here, and these are all connected, is the establishment, the Bretton Woods system, a little place in New Hampshire, where they met in 1944 and concluded treaties by 1946. I want to tell you this, that being a living part of the decolonization process, one of the terms of the British and French and Dutch and German and whatever withdrawal, not German, Belgium, withdrawal from our colonialism was that you must join the Bretton Woods system. What are the terms? You did not get independence unless you agreed to do that. It is one of the silent, unspoken premises of independence, alleged independence. We were filled with hopes. We were warned, I warned, that you have to be careful and let decolonization not be the transfer of a kind of pseudo-sovereignty from a metropolis in Europe to some institution, because mankind has a habit, I think the French have a lovely expression, plus ça change, plus il change. And independence could be one of the greatest examples of nominalist hypocrisy you could ever meet. But there were those then and now who think that you are doomsayer. Believe you me, ladies and gentlemen, the I told you so guy is never late. One of the reasons why my good friend Lyndon LaRouche is not appreciated in America is because every time a tragedy happens, he's the I told you so guy. Plutarch, who made a very, I suppose, insightful remark, Plutarch said, ingratitude towards the great men is a hallmark of strong peoples. But if that were true, the Americans must be very strong to be ungrateful to the genius in their midst. At least that is my estimate, that is my assessment. And I challenge anyone to dispute the accuracy of what I say. But we had ideas. We wanted a new international order. Oh, we wanted to diversify agriculture, put in infrastructure, health, housing, education, industrialize, bring third world, which is very important, developing nations, 85% of mankind lose their aid. Bring them out of the 14th into the 20th century. Brand new. Independence was not an end in itself, but a means to an end. And the end was development. Nations and peoples have to come into existence, have to survive, have to grow, have to develop. Those were aims. But we mistook and misunderstood. The disciples of Keynes, Schacht, and Harry Dexter White, I'm naming the roads, Karl Marx, that monetary priesthood, you know the people who see in a kind of religion of monetarism the hopes and fears of mankind. Where they sought the expectation of good that is embedded in hope, they delivered the expectation of evil, which is a result of fear. Who will pay for it? All this development. Who will pay? And all those disciples of LSE, the London School of Economics, at the Ecole Normale, William Ponty, you know that place? All those, and some from Saint-Cyr, let's be careful, came down and they said, let export receipts be the tools and engines of economic growth. Sell in a competitive world and take your receipts. And use the receipts for development. My friends, I want to suggest to you that the test of any monetary system is its capacity to enshrine institutions of credit. That's the test. It's not whether the US dollar is doing well against the yen, full stop, or what they're doing to the German market. That's a case of it might be an economic quarrel. The important thing is, what institutions of credit do you enshrine? What access do you give to those institutions? How do you distribute credit? That's the key thing of any monetary system. It is not whether only the dollar is monetized in gold. It's not what you do with that. The original sin of the Bretton Woods system, I wonder, the original sin was that the vast majority of mankind in the developing nations, 80% of mankind, told that they could have access to international credit only at the price of the surrender of their sovereignty in the determination of economic policy. Let me give you a concrete example. The British told us when we were being given independence in 64 that although you have to, the British are not very good at purchases, I think you know this, although you have to disengage your money from pound, leave the sterling block, and you must engage with the dollar. So I used to say hi. So Britain would be the political metropole, and America, Washington, the strategic metropole. And so we did. Jamaica, Guyana, Trinidad, you name it. Your money was then pooled. That's the Bretton Woods system, quoted in dollars. And only the dollar is good to go. But we were sovereign. We thought, sovereignty meant sovereignty. And then I had a phone call in 1971 from a secretary in the Ministry of Foreign Trade, which hat I was asked to wear by a heartless prime minister who was very callous in giving responsibilities for policy. The phone call said that Richard Milhouse Nixon, to be quite precise, went on public television, prime time in America, informed the head of the IMF, by the way, the head of the IMF has to be a Western European, the number two has to be American, and the head of the World Bank has to be American, the number two has to be a Western European, which caused great fun with me and Canadians, because they could become nothing and nothing. But, I mean, I had no complaints with myself. They can get anywhere. My Mexican friends, forget all the machismo. Anyway, I received this, he told the IMF head 5 minutes before prime time, and then I was wrong. Nixon has taken the dollar off the gold standard. He has, quote, let the dollar float. It used to be $35 an ounce. It shot up to 800. What that meant, of course, was massive devaluation. Because we at the time were 2 Guyana dollars to 1 US dollar. That was a real exchange. By no act of our own, by a mere imperial order, executive order, as it were, of Nixon, going on television, the money of Guyana and all the third world was divided. That's the meaning of sovereignty. That is the meaning. Well, there were further devaluations as we went along. By the time he was finished, the IMF was finished, as I stand here now, it was $2 to 1 US dollar. It is now officially 20 Guyana dollars to 1 US dollar. And unofficially, in an underground economy of drug, prostitution, gambling, and what have you, it's $30 to 1 US dollar. Right? They have banned the importation of milk. So they say, to save needed foreign exchange. That's what's happening. I don't say this because I believe in evocative phraseology. I say this to remind you that those of you who prefer to live in a cuckoo world, who prefer to think that that's not here, that can't happen, and that those are basket cases down there, let me tell you something. You must tell me what is the difference between America and the third world right now. Because the American debt that these guys, this Reagan guy especially, has caused, would have forced all of us in the third world into the arms of the IMF. To detonation now. And unless you act now, what we have gone through, what I spent all my life to fight, why I am here, and why I value the principle of Lyndon LaRouche, all those things. You may perhaps begin to understand. Money is a political creation. Don't get manipulated. Every time you want to present a political argument, an economic argument, you're told, do not politicize economic processes. That's the economic problem. How a separate panel of that. Have some expert, some denizen, all the tomes, the dusty tomes of Ricardo and Adam Smith. Or what have you. But you must tell me, I have always believed, I have a hard case, and I have enjoyed believing that the important thing about economics is its political equations. That's it. Now, governments have the power to create and to destroy economic systems. That is what happened in 1944-46. They set out to say, what caused World War II? And in Aristotelian fashion, they looked for formal causation and said we had a bad monetary system. We had sterling blocks, and franc blocks, and dollar blocks. We needed a new economic order based on a new system. The idea of the Bretton Woods system after the Russians had decoupled and gone their way by their own machinations is the US dollar would be the only money quoted in gold, and we would all be quoted in US dollars, and institutions will be settled. IBRE, the World Bank, IMF, you know that. I once got into trouble in Guyana with the Speaker of Parliament, attempted to imprison me because I made a very obvious statement that, Mr. Speaker, in IMF, MF means monetary fund. But he didn't understand, of course, you didn't understand the joke I was trying to convey. The thing is, we had IDA. Did you ever hear about the IDA? Where there are levels of poverty. Who is poorer than whom? As though poverty is an absolute, you know. And the IFA, the International Finance Organization, Association, which is to promote capitalism, so to speak, which, in George Shultz's words, and these guys were rough, Shultz, you know, Carlucci, they were in the budget department, Walker. They would say capitalism meant running taxi stands in Zambia. That's a capitalist enterprise they gave you money to pursue. The important thing is that the IMF handled credit systems, that it was bound to be a balance of payments disequilibrium between export receipts and what you imported. You were told you needed to fill the gap, you needed credit, and the IMF controlled that. A kind of collective colonialism, more callous than the colonialism that preceded it. You all went there, and you were subjected to conditionalities. Devalued. Cut down, you've heard this before, cut government spending. Fiscal discipline. Fiscal discipline, untrammeled free market, to which I once told an American ambassador that I must check with my ancestors because he seemed to have suffered terribly from an untrammeled free market system. He was a slave. He had a bad time. You must believe, don't ask for all the sophisticated technology that Lyndon LaRouche has been speaking to us about. Take the California maxim, do your own thing. Burn peat, burn mud and wood, you know. Import cosmetics, don't import medicines. Things of that kind. So I remind them again that slavery itself was appropriate technology. And we had it on that. It fell in deaf ears. I was marked down by my very good friends, the British, as a person who is never satisfied. Hell, I'm never satisfied. So long as a single human being has to live in degradation, so long as we go spiraling down the corridors of ruin, I shall not be satisfied. And that's why I am here. So what did we do? We said we use a fort. In this fight, we go to the OAU, the Organization of African Unity, SELA in Latin America, Sistema Economica Latina Americana, anybody in OAS, all the species. Yeah. CARICOM in the Caribbean, which I was a member, the non-aligned group, By the way, we got the idea from an arrangement from American history. The hypothesis was that Britain and France were the superpowers of the late 18th century, and America essentially non-aligned between them. You know, they'll accept British credit and British protection of their trade, if you like, and they'll accept the French, even if they bring statues of liberty, or send out Pietro Pio, Washington Army, or Rebel Army, Washington's Army, or whether they blockade Cornwallis and Yorktown. But the point is, you're not going to get involved. That was a good idea. That's what you got. Of course, you would follow communism to get to the machine. And we'll use these four. It is in consequence of that, 1976 became a crucial year for me. The year started off with Marcos holding a conference in Manila. And, we all went down there. And, made speeches. I was asked to see the American government. So, being a difficult guy, I went around the world. You know, I left one way through London to Manila, and then came to California. I remember that well, it was snowfall in California, San Francisco. It hadn't done so in 8 years. So obviously something was amazing. And then I came over, and I came to New York, saw a friend. I met Vivian and Nick and people like that, whose names, whose last condition I called now. And then I went down, I met a guy named Henry Kissinger. You heard that name, I suppose? You know, we seem to have in the modern era in America a vast number of educated but unintelligent people. It's a phenomenon. And you can't deny that in a formal way they have been educated. But when you examine their mental processes, the neurotic processes, it's amazing. The guy, I tell you this one, I've got to watch the time, I don't want to overstep. The guy said to me, he started a conference, we discussed it. Why Guyana doesn't vote with America in the UN? He wanted us to vote a certain way, we did not. I said sovereignty, sovereignty, and he cut off aid to Guyana, Tanzania, and some other places. And my president was stupid. Asked me to go and speak to this guy, amendment, I suppose. It's difficult for me to amend it. But my president had a sense of humor. He named his Minister of Finance Hope, which is the expectation of growth. He named his Minister of Trade and Foreign Affairs Wills, who is associated with debt. So I thought he had a sense of humor. Anyway, Kissinger greets me and starts to discuss architecture. And then he starts to discuss music. I follow him. And then he starts to speak about a Periclean age in Greece. I follow him. But I said, this guy is controlling the agenda. And so I must now wrest the agenda from him. Because he's trying to impose his will on us. Understanding in that kind of diplomacy, he will control the agenda, controls the interpretation of current reality. So I said, well, what do you think about development and Zambezi culture? I knew he knew nothing about that. And the minute I said that, he got back to the question. He got back to why I did it. Because he was going to let me send it again. But you have to know how to deal with lunatics of this kind. Yes. He said to me that America loves the third world. And that if we only give America a chance. I said, yeah, but who's speaking for America? Not you. I have been speaking for America more than you have. You know? So he says, I should be telling you that to give America a chance. But in my position in the third world, you can't tell a Secretary of State you must give America a chance. But I did. You know. And all the time, I promise Helga, one of these days I shall regale her with my anecdotes of those. I've met quite a few of these lunatics, you know. I call them a long list of the illustrious obscure. One day, you know that time? Jimmy Carter, Cyrus Vance, Schultz, Carlucci, I met my work. Reagan when he was in California, I've met these people. Never before, in the field of human endeavor, but so much tragedy occasioned by so few. But I don't want to apologize to Winston Churchill. Now, so I went to the UN and I asked for International Resource Bank. A famous gentleman visited me in my hotel. Remember where it was, a Summit Hotel. I had met Tihano and some other guys down in Peru. We arrived in Peru for a conference in 75 and there was a coup d'etat. I mean, Kissinger, his timing was perfect, you know. For a new desk to go over from Alvarez. During the conference, shooting up and bang, and one person opened the conference and one person closed it. Different government. Anyway, in my hotel, quite a few supporters, and a gentleman who had an amazing capacity for cutting out the crap and dealing with reality. And I had that I'd never heard before. Visited me and was speaking. His name is Lyndon. Listen. And I wanted to know, why, how could the Americans indulge the luxury of not having a man like that in their government? Because I tell you this, some of these guys couldn't get in the third world. This guy you have here right now couldn't win a village election in Iraq. The guy you have now. He has one talent, a memory, learning the script of how to swallow his saliva. Yes. That's what his talent is. All you have to do is to put an American flag, and the guy will swallow his saliva and do this and say, God bless America. It's acting. It's espionage. Anyway, so I went to the UN and I asked for international development back then, asked for debt moratorium. I asked for rescheduling and restructuring of debt. A program. I was told I was a lunatic. My friends abandoned me. The Russians called me pro-American, and the Americans called me pro-Russian. The Northern Ireland group felt I was too big for my britches. My president felt I had embarrassed him. So I gave him a book on dialectical economics to read. You said you read it, but I have my books. He had an anomalous problem. And I knew then that it was a question of time when I would be here and lose a job. My problem was how to maximize my actions while I lose a job. And I gave a good run, I enjoyed a good run, and I thank you. We failed. We were defeated. We were defeated by the politicians and by a monetary priesthood I was. Disciples of Keynes and Schiller, Harry Dexter White, who's Joe, who's really Keynes' right hand. Keynes, very senior, Bretton Woods, had two plans, the Keynes plan and the Dexter White plan. And in a surge of American patriotism, they refused the Keynes plan and took the Dexter White plan, not knowing that was also Keynes. That's how international politics work. Always get the other guy to think it's his own. Well, it's yours. When he used to do appeals, you never put your strongest point to the appeal judge. Let him find it out. Get there and he'll find it. But Mr. Wills, isn't it so? He thinks it's his, you know? The rest is his. Now, and Stanford Cripps, you heard of that guy? It's all coming back. It's like, I'm living the thing again. Harold Lasky, you heard of him? That's the kind of voice I am still hearing. 40 years later. In the present crisis, there's been a stagnation and a decline in generalized economics. Economics is not as stupid as the guys at Rutgers, or particularly the guy at Rutgers in Chicago. There's a new school of intellectual endeavor you might like to hear about called Chicagoism. I shan't define it, I'll leave it there. But these guys still believe that economics is a study of allocation of scarce resources or something. I say to you, and you must go with life. Economics is a study of how you establish the preconditions for human coming into existence, survival, growth, and development. That is economics. If you run a ministry as I did, That is what economics is about. That's what it's about. Well, we have a stagnation and a decline in technological progress. That's what we're about. It's aggravated by a spiral growth of pandemics of which you will hear later in another panel. I want to say to you today this. If this planet is destroyed, this planet Earth, it will be because of mismanagement of economic science and not a mismanagement of physical science. That's what I want to say to you. You remind me of the Portuguese. They were looking at some sort of freedom fighters, by the way. So many freedom fighters in my time were fighters against freedom, but I leave that alone. But they were looking there, and they were living on their own doorstep in Portugal, you know. The planet will not be destroyed by a mismanagement of physical science. It could be destroyed by a mismanagement of economic science, and that's why we're here. I want to say to you that bad economic policies have led to highly suspect counting feats, damage limitation. That's what they're doing. But we have now transcended the possibilities of arithmetical illusion. We've gone beyond it. You know, after a while, you can juggle books, you can work your symbolisms, but there's starvation, disease, and hunger, what have you, rampant. And those tricks no longer work. The time for palliatives and for exhaustively verbal panaceas is over. This is a time for fresh procedures. And that's why we are here. This is a time for surgery. And that's why we are here. Life on this planet is too valuable to be left to the idiosyncrasies and foibles embellished in the numberless idiocies of the contemporary economists, you know, Baker and that lot. They have failed. They and their policies must go. It is time to return to the fundamental appreciation that money and monetary systems are the servants of humanity. They are not ends in themselves. It is time to appreciate that we have reached not only a crisis in the interpretation of reality, as I said before, but that we need a qualitative change in the system, the financial systems of this world. We need new private mechanisms, that's why we are here. We need new modulating for the generation of human survival, new modulating for the generation of human growth, new modulating for the generation of human development. We need rational avenues of access by everyone, OECD, developing nations, to all the new credit mechanisms we might create. The need for intervention is clear. We cannot remain passive in the presence of impending catastrophe. Our intervention, as exemplified by this conference, must be based on reason. The choice of action by reason over action by feelings and appetites is not a mere choice of options for what they like in the halls of leadership in these days. When reason is ignored, the forces of nature serve up terrible reminders. Just reread the history of the 14th century. That's all you have to do. We must have confidence in new technologies that illuminate man's horizon at the moment. And our development, and the pathways to development, must be consistent with scientific principles. Poverty, starvation, famine, disease, recession, depression are not culturally ordained. They are not the permanent pillars of cultural relativism. Stop going down to the third world where 80% of mankind lives and tell them that is your way of doing things. Stop. Stop that! Stop carrying Racine and Molière, carrying Pasteur and Madame Curie. We must not and cannot allow the earth to degenerate into a pandemic wilderness. I say to you, we cannot furl the flags of human promise. That is what this conference is about. Once again, we are meant to establish a new monetary system. We are not here to repeat the mistakes of the old. Above all, we are not here to deify, hallow the assumptions of the old system. We are here because we know that mankind need not remain passive in the face of impending doom. But if we don't do it, there's nobody left to do it. We are the thin red line standing on the lip of promise. If we lose, such personal battles and personal tragedy is a decision about whether mankind on this planet has a future. I therefore ask you, in the name of those present, in the name of those departed, who have been in this fight for a new economic order, a new monetary system, and new mechanisms of credit, I ask you not to let us fail again. True, we've come back to the Northeast. Bretton Woods is in New Hampshire and here in Andy. But that's a mere anomalous coincidence. I think we have the intelligence in this room, the leadership, and the directionality, and the advocates to triumph over the present.